Christ's sakes, what the hell kind of a needle is that? Shit, Doug, I got the flu. I don't need any shot.
Just relax, Mr. Ruby. This'll calm you down, clear all this up.
Heck, I'm telling you, I don't need or want no shot.
Ruby died at 10 a.m. on January 3rd, 1967 of pancreatic cancer. He was diagnosed and he died quickly within a month. For certain cancers like pancreatic, this is not unusual. But what is unusual is that Ruby had just been granted a retrial. Ruby had expressed concern for his life, as you saw in his testimony to the Warren Commission, and in letters from jail and conversations with the deputy sheriff. And he told that sheriff he had been injected with cancer cells under the guise of a cold treatment, which is why we dramatized the previous scene about the flu. Perhaps crudely, but at least it's a breakthrough. Bear in mind at the time of Ruby's death, and this applies across the board to our policy of secret government, the U.S. government was actively developing bacteriological weapons and toxins at the Army Chemical Corps Research Center at Fort Detrick, Maryland. We knew about the MK Ultra, whatever it was called, the mind program to change and hypnotize people using LSD, large doses. People committed suicide. It was quite wild in the 50s. But the point I think we should just accept in realistic black is white and white is black, we're through the looking glass terms of this movie, is that while allegations of cancers and heart attacks and other deaths that are convenient may sound paranoid and far-fetched, the U.S. military and intelligence agencies did, in undisputed and documented fact, develop these capabilities.
And there are many things at stake, Mr. Ruby, in this affair.
Mm-hmm. But if I'm eliminated, there won't be any way of knowing the truth pertaining to my situation.
I think in showing you the whole extract, we're allowing you to see more dialogue that Ruby actually said, as well as the Warren Commission, and at the same time you're seeing the dramatization of a potential murder scenario with Ruby being injected.
You think I'm screwy?
Well, I don't know what to do because I don't know what you anticipate we would encounter.
Then you don't stand a chance, Mr. Chief Justice. You have a lost cause. Because all I want is a lie detector test, and you refuse to give it to me. And the true serum, the, how do you pronounce it? The pentothal, whatever it is. They won't give it to me. Because I want to tell the truth. And then, I want to leave this world.
Mankind must put an end to war. A war will put an end to mankind.
Hello.
The world must hear this.
Sissy, I thought, did an excellent job of playing it straight, which is, you know, I encouraged her to rehearse and try anything she wanted. But, you know, we really felt politically correct is not the way to play these kinds of roles. I mean, this is revisionism of the worst order, and I see it in movies all the time, where the woman assumes a harder, a tougher character, a more independent character. Supposedly, you know, that's of course, it's a woman that's exciting and stronger, but sometimes there are women who are not like that. And that is what this is, a 1950s, 60s type woman, a housewife in the South. She's really concerned about her kids, and she's concerned that her husband's out on a limb. And Sissy, in her Texas way, to me, conveys that hardness, that toughness. Jim Garrison's announcement of his prosecution brought tremendous publicity and attention to him, and his office was just swamped with people. Some with genuine leads, some with completely insane leads. And there was devils, there was all kinds of New Orleans types. And We had a little fun with the scene, but it's not too far from the truth. I mean, Jim also did not have a staff for this, you know. This is a huge prosecution involving dozens and dozens of major witnesses. Depositions had to be written, plaintiff issues, and you need a huge staff, and he didn't have it. I mean, I even simplified Jim's staff. I mean, for example, Jay Sanders, Lou Ivan, did not join the staff until later. There was another prosecutor who told him the news of Kennedy's death, and they went to the restaurant together. But we did not have time to go through all the changes in staff. But I do miss the concept of him reading Newsweek magazine and showing us how the American media so quickly perverted his mission and went after him with a broadsword, really, to destroy his reputation.
He was often an unwilling witness, $3,000, if only he would fill in the facts of the alleged meeting to plot the death of the president. Gee, is that true?
Hell no.
Well, then how can they write it?
Oh, Jim.
Look, they call me a charlatan, a hulking DA. I'm power mad. And we got morbid frolic in New Orleans.
Crazy, they're taking over the asylum, Jim. It's a zoo out there.
Sensational garbage sells newspapers, Jim. What else is new?
Well, how can they say that?
Numa Bertel, who's played here by Wayne Knight, is a very sweet character. And he's very supportive of his boss, reading him the letters from the family. It's so true. I mean, Jim did get thousands of letters from individual citizens, which is a dichotomy I myself faced in some ways in JFK. People saying, you know, you're doing the right thing and keep it up. People who understood what he was going through and who were rooting for him. And I think Wayne Knight brings out sort of a Capra-esque quality that I like at that moment. It's a little corny, but it's good corn.
And there's more where that came from. That's what it's all about, Jim. That's what it's about. For every lousy article in the press, there's a thousand of these.
But that's just fine, Numa. But what about all the people who aren't writing letters,
It's offset, of course, by Michael Rooker, who I'd seen in Portrait of a Serial Killer, and put him in as Broussard, Bill Broussard, who plays a composite character, really, in this movie, of several people. But basically, one of these people was a traitor to Jim. And this you will understand as the movie progresses. But you see early signs of Michael Rooker's fears here in this scene, as well as a very key moment when Miller has finished his pitch to bribe Jim, and Jim looks over at Michael. Michael almost, if you look closely enough, is nodding his head, yes, like take the deal. So, his staff is quite split.
But sometimes when things make no sense, it's exactly the time when you just got to stick your head down and keep going.
Yeah.
Mr. Miller? Jim Garrison.
He did get an offer during the course of his investigation from this strange oil man from Denver called Mr. Miller. He writes about him in his book, On the Trail of the Assassins. It's a very powerful scene, and I tried to dramatize it as such. But because it existed independently and was part of the concept of the threat against Jim Garrison, and there were other threats in the movie, I let it go and didn't push it. Although I do find the concept of Miller a very interesting character.
I have the means to back up what I say.
Well, we could use all the support we can get. I think these might interest you. They've been enlarged, and they show a lot
of...
I'd
love to see them. Splendid. Where were you? Europe or the Pacific?
Germany.
Oh, you were lucky. I spent 3 years in the Pacific. You know, I've never seen an avenue with such a profusion of bail bond companies. Well, why is that?
I imagine because this is the criminal district court building. This is an enlargement of a potential shooter.
No, yes, I've heard of that shot. Terrible tragedy. How much do you have for carrying on your investigation?
If you must know, virtually nothing.
And how many men do you have working with you on it?
Less than you would expect. Most days, 2 to 3 assistant DAs, handful of investigators.
That's all you've had all this time?
That's all.
As he says, in the scene, maybe 2 people a day, 3 people a day. So it really strained his resources, and it exhausted him. Jim was unable to argue most of the trial. He He let his prosecuting attorneys argue it, and he himself went a few times, but he made his final speech in his name. Jim very much was an eloquent man, which very few people realize, is that he did speak in cadence sentences. He had studied Shakespeare extensively. He was a very well-educated man. And coming from the Midwest, he originally had been, born in, his family came from Indiana. He was a New Orleans man most of his life. And his mother lived in Mississippi, I believe, and we had a scene once with her and him visiting her. She was a tough old dame. I got Angela Lansbury to say yes to it, but I eventually abandoned the idea of shooting it because the script was already so long, I was only worried about going off tack. So that's one of the reasons this scene was cut, as much as I liked it. It didn't seem to be necessary to the concept of building threat.
Here you're just trying to scale Mount Everest on the steep side. I propose that you accept an appointment to the bench in Federal District Court. Move into a job worthy of a man of your talent. Do you have any idea, any conception of how easily such an appointment can be arranged?
What would I have to do?
Stop your investigation. It's been a magnificent effort, but it's over and done with. Hell, the press is already on your butt.
Jim did get pounded in the media, culminating in the NBC one-hour white paper on Jim Garrison, which you'll see later in the film. It's just was an utterly destructive document, unbelievable to watch now, to realize what the sledgehammer television could be in those days, without one shred of objectivity.
I guarantee it.
You guarantee it. Who are you, Mr. Miller?
Who are you, Mr. Miller, to me is a key line. Who are you, Mr. Miller? What do you represent that you can guarantee a federal judgeship? Well, obviously some high-up person. I find him very threatening. The actor is wonderful. The actual helmet that you saw, the Nazi helmet with a hole in the bullet hole in it, was from Jim's desk. I saw it there. And he did keep it that way. Jim fought in both wars, Korea and World War II. He was a true believer, believe it or not. Really a bit of the old-fashioned Capra sentimentality about him. I think that Frank Capra was very much his generation. I think Capra represented in the 1930s, fascism in this country very powerfully in his movies, although many people miss the message and blame Capra for sentimentality, but they miss the harshness of vision that Capra really has about the mob scene, the mob, the vigilante rule, the money buys, the mob, the mentality of several of his films in the 1930s.
Murder. Bill, Mr. Miller and I are through with our conversation. Would you show him out?
When he leaves the room and he looks at Garrison, he doesn't say anything. It's an interesting way of leaving the room. It somehow seems more menacing and malignant.
Those bastards!
Well, they offered you the carrot and you turned it down. You know what's coming next, don't you, boss?
I was young. I was scared.
Beverly Oliver also is one of these people who is an internexus between history and fantasy. She's a woman who tells us the most incredible story. That's why I cut back and forth to this club to her. I love Lolita's performance, and I cut it down too much. I regret it. It's fully rounded in the outtake. Another stupid mistake made in the first cut of the film, but it does happen. You live to regret them. She was like Marilyn Monroe to me. She was somebody who was beautiful and filled with the love of life and not thinking like a bird, not thinking about too much about things or tomorrow, just living the moment. But she definitely was very clear that something big was going on in Dallas that couple of months, you know, something big. And she was there at the Dealey Plaza, and she said what she saw. But you gave the film the F- she saw the same puffs of smoke at the fence that Bowers, the railroad man in the signal tower behind the fence, saw.
Somehow they knew that I'd take the movies.
We're from the FBI. We understand you were at the Plaza on Friday.
Why didn't you develop the film, Beverly?
I hadn't finished the role.
I have it right here in my camera.
A lot of people say she's full of shit and blah, blah, blah. And it's easy to say that about people who live in this fringe. You really can. Anybody who's done dope, anybody who's done something bad in their lives, you can be a blue nose and say, how can you believe him? You know, who are you going to have in court? Who are going to be your witnesses? They're all going to be a bunch of pompous people who haven't lived a life. Through flaws, people learn. So I think that sometimes the best people are the people who are what you think below us in society in that criminal element or something. But sometimes they're smarter. And they know something, they've learned something, and they're more wise, and they should be listened to. There's redemption in everything. There's redemption of finally in crime. Dostoevsky said this. Even through crime, you can become a better person. It's not necessarily your path you want to take, but at least it's a path of redemption. I've heard so many stories from people. I mean, you have to realize that I hear stories preparing for the film and after the film from many different people, and many of them are quite amazing, and some of them I don't use because I don't believe them. Or I don't feel they're substantial enough to put in the film. Let's say I hear five stories about this club carousel from five different people. I try to find a median of behavior. But certainly I heard about fights at the club carousel one night where I even heard there was a fight between Oswald and Ruby was a bouncer type and broke it up and threw Oswald out or something. I heard that story. I heard a lot of strange stories because I did actually run into a few people besides Marina who knew Oswald, you see, or told me they did. But I'd have to weed it out, you know. I'd have to weed it out as to what Oswald was, you see. Oswald is many things to many people, but I've done this before. There's things that you attribute to, you see, when you deal with, like Harrison did with a criminal element, you're in a world of sleazebags. But, you know, that doesn't mean that everybody lies all the time. It means that they split the truth, you know. And there's a lot of characters in this case that come from this world, from David Ferry to Lee Oswald to Beverly Oliver. I mean, Beverly knew these people. And her girlfriend getting offed or disappearing like that really shook her. God damn, it's such a sad story, this JFK, because what really it's all about is redemption. It's just like, no, it's not. It's about Kevin Costner looking to live the right life, to live the truth, and to redeem himself by so doing. And in the process, he must destroy himself, basically. As a human being, he must change his entire life. And that's really what's going on. Kevin Costner is very muted, wore the tortoise shell glasses at his own request, the hat, hid his face. He wasn't at all grandstanding. He was the opposite. He was trying to disappear inside scenes. Kevin was very smart. He anchored the film thereby. You know, he thereby kind of took us through the film.
Fred speaking.
Howdy, Cap. I want to thank you for taking care of us down in Dallas.
Thank you, Mr. President. We're doing our best.
Cap, I know you've been working like a dog.
We take dramatic license with the high official implying that it was probably Lyndon Johnson who was speaking to Will Fritz. This is based on some information that came to me at the time, not necessarily information that is to be authenticated. I can't say to you that we know. Perhaps there's been some new research. But there's no question from eyewitnesses that Lyndon Johnson had an overriding interest in the case right away and was very much on top of it and wanted to know where Dallas was in the investigation. And above all, did not want a prosecution out of Texas, you see, because that's his home state. He basically substitutes the Warren Commission very shortly thereafter for a real significant research into the investigation. So Oswald is very clearly says repeatedly, I had nothing to do with this, I am just a patsy, which Gary Oldman worked on for months to get his dialect right. He was so beautiful, Gary, in the role. I thought he was so believable. He almost creates to me another Oswald, you know, another layer for Lee Harvey Oswald. It really did him justice because Lee Harvey Oswald was a very much maligned and misunderstood man. And I do believe, ultimately, he was a patsy. He was used. That's not to say he was innocent, because I do think he was dirty to some degree. Gary Oldman studied the transcripts that we had on Oswald, and we tried to stick as close as we could to the exact dialogue, which is rendered in a very robotic American-Russian combination by Gary, who actually is a method actor who kind of lives the role of a spy. He was, like, very strange for weeks as he was, like, building this alienation up. Everybody will know who I am now is, to me, the ultimate Kafka statement coming from him, because he is Kafka. He is the modern Kafka. There could be nothing more horrendous than what he went through in those few days. But he never had the trial because Ruby managed, unknown to anybody apparently, to walk into a garage filled with 70 cops on Sunday morning and guys who were assigned to protect Oswald and to walk right up to him and shoot him in the gut. I mean, that's great protection from 70 cops. They're really paying attention. And how did Ruby get into the garage in the first place?
Who grieves for Lee Harvey Oswald? Buried in a cheap grave under the name Oswald?
Kafka. It was a nightmare. I don't know if he ever thought he'd have a trial. If he did, that's perhaps why he was cool. Maybe he figured he'd get off at the trial.
I was young.
We shot this scene in the middle of the film somewhere because Gary was really exploding. Gary Oldman was exploding with emotion. A sense of intuition about Lee Harvey Oswald that was very moving. He came to me one day and he said, look, Gary never asked for very much. He just maybe put the camera on me, just shoot me a little bit talking at the trial. I just have something to say. And it turned into this beautiful monologue that he said, really from his heart. It was hard for him to speak it. He was really struggling. We shot it late, we were tired. You know, we didn't make too much of it because it sounded pretty wacky at times, you know. But it really holds up, and that's why I'm putting it on as the last piece. Somehow it's a coda, it's a fitting coda to the sadness of the whole thing with ending with Jim and Mr. X at the monument to go to the other side, the loser, the man in the grave. And he's speaking from beyond the grave, and it's just a beautiful moment. I just, you know, obviously would have ended the film on a wholly different note. You know, ask yourself what it would have done. And you sense, I think, here the love he had for Marina, the tenderness, and also for his children, the two children who I met when they grew up, and how tough a life he had, how divided and tortured a life he had.
Bullet didn't silence me. It only made my voice louder.
It's based not on any known dialogue, except maybe one or two sentences we heard about Guy Bannister being a sinister man, I think was a quoted word, but not very much. It was really Gary's intuition, based on months of work and research and living his role.
Lee Harvey Oswald is innocent.
I also love the parallelism between the two graves, between Jackie and Marina.
I didn't do it.
The wrong man. I, Lee Harvey Oswald, am innocent. And when he goes to Washington to see Donald Sutherland, it comes down on him like a ton of bricks. That's the end of the first half of the movie. There should have been an intermission afterward, as they do in Europe, 20 minutes, just for allow you to absorb all that stuff that Donald Sutherland is saying. I mean, Costner's exhausted. So that was the end of the first half in the final version of the film. Unfortunately, they don't do that anymore, so we rushed into the second half, and so I think some people do get lost and they don't have a chance to absorb all this information. But certainly the intermission is a great idea to come back to America. I say that in reference to this upcoming scene, which is the alternate outtake of the film, which is the way it was scripted. I divided the scene with Donald Sutherland, which ran now to 12 pages or something, which was too long, into two scenes, and I had him. After the trial, I had Garrison with some perspective meet X again between the obelisk and the Lincoln Monument. But, you know, it was anticlimactic after what we'd been through emotionally. It was more information. So ultimately, I made the decision personally just to move this to the middle and try to combine both scenes, which took some tricks. If you look very closely at the resulting film scene, I think you may see some dislocations, dubbing done. I know that we tried, you know, we had to do some magic tricks in the editing room to pull that off, to make the two scenes work, but I think it was a big breakthrough for us. It allowed us to finish the film in a very more dramatic way. But I still like this alternate ending, and I'd love you to watch it with me and just sort of sense the way it flowed unto itself, because there is other information here.
It's conversations, nothing more. Generals, admirals, CIA people, probably some people on the inside of Kennedy's staff.
I love the speech by Sutherland. I mean, in the wind, money, in the loop, in the wind. It's in the wind. I mean, it's not like the, again, I repeat, not like a bunch of conventioneers getting together and saying we're going to knock off the president. It's in the wind. You don't talk. You whisper the idea. The idea is whispered. And only certain people, 10 to 20, maybe a little bit more, are really in the know. And I was trying to be very specific. I'm not saying that this is the way it went down, but this is Fletcher Prouty, Lieutenant Colonel Fletcher Prouty's idea of how it went down.
Before the election, he can't afford to. I hear the NSC.
Kennedy was the first president ever in National Security Action Memorandum 55 to turn over the secret budgets and the stockpiling of weapons by the CIA back to the Pentagon. That was a very important decision. It was never effected, unfortunately, because bureaucracies don't work that way. They don't actually do what your president signs. But the idea was, Kennedy, who had said he would splinter the CIA to 1,000 pieces, fired Dulles, Bissell, Cabell, was really taking on the dirty war here. Kennedy put it on paper, National Security Action Memorandum 263. In this paper, McNamara and Taylor, his two guys, had come back from Vietnam, and they had a meeting on October 3rd. McNamara and Taylor were weakening on the war. They were saying that this is corruption is too rampant in the South Vietnamese ranks. You can see it. So-called communists under Ho Chi Minh are really organized. This is an unwinnable situation in the jungle. And they started to back away. Again, even more strongly than before. However, their language was clouded, as it generally would be from advisors. It was never a definite. But it was Kennedy who took that statement of October 3rd, memorandum of October 3rd, and turned it into National Security Action Memo on October 11th called 263. And that was the memo that has been printed and printed and says, take out the 1,000 guys. I mean, it's our intention to withdraw all the troops by 65. But 273, which was issued by Johnson, never refers to 263. You see, they're very clever. It only refers to the memorandum of October 3rd, 1963, that which is the weaker languaged memorandum of McNamara and Taylor.
There's been no vote. Nothing's on paper. There's no one to blame. It's as old as the crucifixion. A mafia firing squad. 5 bullets, 1 blank, no one's guilty. Because everybody in the power structure who knows anything has a plausible deniability. There are no compromising connections except at the most secret point. But what's paramount is that it must succeed. No matter how many die, no matter how much it costs, the perpetrators must be on the winning side and never subject to prosecution for anything by anyone. That's a coup d'etat.
Sure. Nothing on paper, the crucifixion, a mafia firing squad. Plausible deniability. Treason does always prosper, said an English poet, because none dare call it treason if it succeeds.
Second Oswald start popping up all over Dallas where they have the mayor and the cops in their pocket. General Y flies in the assassins.
Prouty slash Donald Sutherland brought a very clear objective to me that it didn't matter. That was scenery. Who shot who, when, who the shooters were. He just says prose. Could have been pros. They were just trained. And he said, implied that it would have been done in a trained way. It wouldn't have done with some jack-off Cuban group that didn't fire straight, you know, gang couldn't shoot straight. And it wouldn't be using mafia guys who never had done this kind of work. You need professionals, guys who are not going to melt under pressure. And guys who don't know who they're working for, and they don't even know who they're going to kill. I mean, they may be told a half an hour before, you're at the square, you're going to shoot somebody who's going to try to kill the president. It could have been the other way around. You don't know. And then you get the order, the target is in the car, you know. How do you know what the hell's going on? Maybe you think it's a double. I mean, there's no, you're a military man. You're a military mission. And above all, you know how to shut up. That's what these drooling intellectuals in Washington, these people who constantly attack the film, don't understand, is that serious people do shut up. It's because they have such loose tongues and love to gossip. They think everybody's like them. They're not. I'd just as soon kill some of these colonists with their big mouths, then listen to another Columbine. I mean, I really feel that way. And I'm not a military sniper, but I talk for a lot of military minds that feel that way. These people are just insolent. There are serious people out there who are doing serious research for nothing, just because they care. Please care. Please make an effort just to listen to some tiny flicker of hope from the other side, because you're not getting it in the establishment media. They are constantly cutting out these stories. They're burying them. There's no pattern to them. They are vicious, and they have fucked up so deeply back in 63. The decision was made in the first 72 hours that Oswald did it alone, and they were ahead of the cops. I mean, the Herald Tribune in New York and the New York Times were the worst. Anthony Lewis and James Reston, two of the most respected columnists of the time, wrote within 3 days attacking Oswald's madness. How did they know?
Like it never happened.
It never did.
And there's another great line of dialogue there that we slipped in at the end, where Costner leans back on the bench, and this is really nostalgic, wistful, and says, it never happened. And Sutherland says, it never did, which is the greatest answer to all these people who say, how can a conspiracy get away with it? They got away with it. They got away with it.
Drugs, thought control, guild assassinations. We never recovered from that, did we? Never recovered from Dallas. Never able to trust our government again.
I keep thinking about that day. Tuesday, the 26th of November, the day after they buried Kennedy.
Gentlemen.
LBJ was signing that memorandum on Vietnam. Gentlemen. With Ambassador Lodge.
I'm not going to let Vietnam go like China did. I'm personally committed. Now, I'm not going to take one soldier out of there till they know we mean business in Asia.
And that was the day Vietnam started.
Johnson clearly set a new course in Vietnam on that Sunday that Kennedy was being buried. So the end scene in this is correct. It's correct. 273 sealed our fate the day Kennedy was buried. There is such Greek irony in this. It is like a classic Shakespearean ploy. The day the man's being buried and you're signing this document of war that is totally in contradiction to Kennedy's intentions. I think Orson Welles, if he'd been alive, and he was alive during this, should have really made this movie. But it's interesting to note that sometimes when you're living through the event in the present tense and you've aged and you're an older man, it doesn't quite have the same impression on you as it does. But he was an older man when Kennedy was killed, and perhaps, I mean, he had that jigsaw mind. I wondered what he thought. I don't know if he thought very much about it, but I just think you need that present time energy to do these kinds of movies. You must care about the time in which you grow, and that generally affects younger people. What's been very sad to me in the last few years is that none of the younger people, very few of them, have written or directed movies that have significant contemporary social events. Very few. And it's partly because the media drives off any such interpreters of patterns in the news, and they do it regularly, scare them off really economically through the studios. It's a shame. And I hope a few people will emerge with the guts and the strength to carry on. That's why the film is dedicated to the young and whose spirit, the search for truth, marches on.